Management Committee Liaison for 2021, and I'm glad to be here today to kick off the first of our four advocacy training sessions we are hosting for the Texas Realtors Legislative Contact Teams. All throughout our government affairs orientation, you have heard how critical it is for us to build and foster relationships with our elected officials, our legislative contact team, and this program does just that with our members of the Texas legislature. Between now and the start of the Texas legislative session, we will be hosting trainings for you all to fine-tune your skills as a relationship builder and a Texas Realtors advocate. Joining us this afternoon is Brad Fitch, President and CEO of the Congressional Management Foundation. Brad started his communications career at the age of 16, working at his local AM radio station in upstate New York as a disc jockey and as a reporter. After grad school, he worked as a television reporter in Washington, moving to Capitol Hill for 13 years as a press secretary, legislative director, and chief of staff. In 2001, he served as the deputy director of CMF, a nonprofit dedicated to improving congressional operations and citizen engagement. He left CMF in 2006 to form a successful internet startup before returning to CMF in 2010. Fitch is frequently quoted in national media outlets on how Congress works. He's also the author of the Citizen's Handbook to Influencing Elected Officials and Media Relations Handbook for agencies, associations, nonprofits, and Congress. You may also be familiar with Brad and Congressional Management Foundation through some of the training they do for the National Association of Realtors and for their FPCs. Throughout the session, if you do have questions, please submit them in the question and answer box that's located below the video box on your screen. At the end of the training session, we should have a few minutes for questions, and we'll do our best to answer your questions. Brad, welcome, and thank you for being here with us today.
Well, Tom, thank you very much, and thanks for, again, inviting me virtually to Texas and the opportunity to talk to all of your realtors. And as Tom said, the Congressional Management Foundation is a nonpartisan, non-policy oriented organization. We don't lobby Congress. We work with both Democrats and Republicans. As Tom said, to improve the operations of the institution, we're kind of like small business consultants. But about 15 years ago, we started taking a greater interest in citizen engagement as the internet was affecting advocacy. And so we do surveys of congressional staff, focus groups, interviews with members of Congress about how you can have a greater voice at the state capitol and in Washington. Now, some of the data you're going to hear today is coming from our research with the United States Congress. But I want to assure you, especially when it comes to storytelling, it doesn't matter what level of official you're working with, state, federal, or local. All the research on storytelling and persuasion indicates that the emotional side of these lawmakers and their decision making is what appeals to them. Is they're rational beings? Yes, of course. But it's the storytelling that really makes a difference. So that's what we're starting with today. First, asking our question, why storytelling? Well, let me bring you some data from the Congressional Management Foundation surveys of congressional staff. Now, we survey them on a almost quarterly basis about what motivates them, how things work on Capitol Hill, how you could have a greater voice. And one of the set of questions we asked had to do with storytelling, not specifically, but with what influences them. So one of the questions we asked in our survey went like this: how helpful is it for messages from constituents to include the following? And then we compare that to is how frequently do you get messages from constituents to include the following? And one of the options was telling a personal story. And this is what we found out is that 79% of congressional staff said telling a personal story related to the bill or issue would be helpful or very helpful, but only 18% of staff said they get it very frequently or frequently. This means that those constituents who tell personal stories to their state and federal lawmakers are differentiating themselves from 4 out of 5 people who don't tell personal stories. And that's why we do a program like this on storytelling. The other thing to realize is that we are storytelling animals. We like to think of ourselves as rational, emotionless decision makers, right? One neuroscientist said it this way. He said, human beings are not rational. They are emotional that occasionally are rational. And that's what happens. Because we like to think of ourselves as individuals that ponder a question, we analyze the question, and we come up with a decision. But guess what? That's not how our brains are wired. The neuroscience tells us this, that we're actually more of like things that see something, we then feel it, and then we make the decision. And it's this feeling part that is really at the core of this presentation and at the core of popular persuasion. Now, you all know, how many times have you been with a client and they quote unquote fall in love with a house? I know I did when I came to my home in Fairfax, Virginia. You see it the same way in your business, that it's that emotional tie. Believe it or not, it's no different in advocacy. In fact, neuroscience research shows us that you actually affect the brain chemicals of an audience. And that is something that's really kind of freaky when you think about it, but you actually having that kind of power. The other reason why storytelling is essential in advocacy is our attention span as individuals, as human beings, and certainly this is true for legislators and their staffs, is very, very brief. And it's getting briefer. Because if you look back in the 1980s, when we had all this around us, our attention span was about 22 seconds. It means we get distracted another 22 seconds. As time went on and we got more and more gadgets and more complicated things, our attention span dropped to 12 seconds. And in fact, even as a few years ago, it broke down to 9 seconds. So you may say to yourselves, are you telling me that our brain is only 9 seconds? We can only deal with something for 9 seconds? Well, actually, no. 9 seconds is the attention span of a goldfish. By 2020, human beings' attention span has now dropped to 2.8 seconds. So if you don't have a story that gets the attention of a public policy official or their staff member, you're really going to have a hard time breaking through, as they are dealing with a myriad of different data points and constituents and information coming into their field of view. Now, what we're going to do here today is we're going to walk you through the elements of advocacy storytelling. It's a 6-step method that really is like a cookie cutter paint by numbers exercise that is going to make it easier for you to have a little fun. We're actually going to show you some movie clips, which is always good after lunch in the afternoon to keep people awake, that are examples of those elements from a popular movie you have probably seen. We're then going to play you a story that we recorded during one of our training sessions with the National Association, in this particular case, talking about flood insurance. What's fascinating about the story, and you'll hear, is you're not going to know it's about flood insurance when the story talks. And then we're going to reverse engineer it, and you're going to hear, listen for those 6 elements of advocacy storytelling. And at the end, we're going to be providing you a handout that you can use to build your own stories. It really is more of a paint by numbers exercise than you might think. And we all know that sometimes Hollywood is formulaic. If you've watched any Disney films from Pixar, you know there is a formula to it. Well, advocacy storytelling follows a different formula, but it's still a formula. So let's get started. Before any screenwriter begins writing out their story, they first ask themselves, what is the end? Where do I want to go? Begin with the end in mind. So you're going to know where you're going, because if you don't know where you're going, any road will take you there. You know that you're going to be trying to get a lawmaker to co-sponsor a bill, vote for a bill, vote against a bill. You want to know what the ask is in advance. Again, that doesn't mean you reveal it early on. We didn't see the shark in Jaws until more than halfway through the film. The storyteller also lays the groundwork, and they kind of get the audience ready to receive the full message. And you're going to want to consider various tactics as you build your story out. This will all make a little more sense to you as you see the elements of storytelling I'm about to show you. The first one we're going to start with, the opening, is establishing the stakes. Members of Congress and state legislators, when they're interacting with a constituent, are listening very carefully for something like this. Congressman, if we don't do X, Y will happen. That's the stake. That is at stake. That is them explaining what is at stake. And they're listening for that because they know there are policy and political consequences if they miss that. Now, to give you an example of how we set the stage and establish the stakes, I'm going to play for you a clip from the movie Lincoln, where in this particular scene, Abraham Lincoln establishes the stakes for a constitutional amendment to abolish slavery.
Good morning. can listen to this anymore. Can't accomplish a goddamn thing of any human meaning or worth until we cure ourselves of slavery and end this pestilential war. Any of you or anyone else knows it, I know I need this. This amendment is that cure. We're stepped out upon the world stage now. Now! The fate of human dignity in our hands. Blood's been spilled to afford us this moment. Now, now, now.
Now, hopefully, when you are doing your advocacy, you won't have the fate of human dignity in your hands. But you get the idea that you want to lay out for a individual lawmaker, policymaker, or staffer what is at stake in any particular decision that they may make or may not make. So that's element number one, setting the stage and establishing the stakes. Element number two, let me go a little more detail. So you want to make that first sentence or two be a hook that gets their attention. You want to put the context for the life you're going to be describing. And again, as I said, what's at stake for a client, for a family, for your business? So clarify that. Now let's go on to element number two, which is painting the picture, the details and the senses. This is the adjectives part of this. And many storytellers in an advocacy setting don't do that. They miss the sort of the painting the picture, the details of it. And to give you an illustration of what I mean about this, I'm going to take a clip from probably one of your favorite movies, and that's Apollo 13 with Tom Hanks. In this particular scene, he's already in trouble. He's up in space on Apollo 13, and they're running a clip that his family is watching from an earlier interview he did. And in this particular case, Tom Hanks, as the astronaut, paints a picture. Let's listen.
Is there a specific instance in an airplane emergency when you can recall fear?
Well, I tell you, I remember this one time. I'm in a Banshee at night in combat condition, so there's no running lights on the carrier. It was the Shangri-La. We were in the Sea of Japan, and my radar had jammed, and my homing signal was gone because somebody in Japan was actually using the same frequency, and so it was leading me away from where I was supposed to be. And I'm looking down at a big black ocean, so I flip on my map light, and then suddenly, zap, everything shorts out right there in my cockpit. All my instruments are gone, my lights are gone, and I can't even tell now what my altitude is. I know I'm running out of fuel, so I'm thinking about ditching in the ocean, and I look down there, and then in the darkness, there's this green trail. It's like a long carpet that's just laid out right beneath me, and it was the algae, right? It was that phosphorescent stuff that gets churned up in the wake of a big ship, and it was just leading me home. And now, if my cockpit lights hadn't shorted out, there's no way I'd have ever been able to see that. So you never know what events are going to transpire to get you home.
It's fascinating how Hanks brings that to life by talking about the green algae, the lights going out. And that was the story. That was the elements. Without those details, you're not going to get it. So ask yourself, when you're building your story, what did you see, hear, touch, taste, or smell? Remember to use adjectives. In fact, as a check, when you get done drafting the concept of your story and talking points, or if you write it out, ask yourself what adjectives you're going to use, because this is, again, the easiest way to add details to the story by simply adding, and I don't mean it was very hot. I literally worked with one group. I'm not kidding. The storyteller started it with, it was a dark and rainy night. And it was a story about a drug deal gone bad that this particular group is dealing with. So it was actually a rather gripping story. But the point is, they were painting a picture, and that's what we want you to do. Make it real. Be practical. Don't hold anything back. Most members of Congress and state legislator meetings are boring. I know, I've been in thousands of them. And most people will just read their talking points from the state association or the national association. They're looking for something a little more real, and painting the picture is going to do it. Okay, the next element, element number three, is the struggle. Describe the fight. You always want that protagonist in a difficult situation, trying to overcome some form of adversity. You know, think about the stories that you listen to, think about the heroes you listen to, and what does the struggle that they're going through. And the movie that I'm going to share with you, the clip, which really describes the struggle in great detail, is from the great movie Selma, in which the character, in this case, portraying Martin Luther King, was in Selma to get the right to vote, or the Voting Rights Act.
As long as I am unable to exercise my constitutional right to vote, I do not have command of my own life. I cannot determine my own destiny, what is determined for me by people who would rather see me suffer than succeed. Those that have gone before us say, no more, no more. That means protest, that means march, that means disturb the peace, that means jail, that means risk, and that is hard. We will not wait any longer.
Now, that's obviously a very vivid, massive way of describing the struggle. But we want you to think in similar terms as you describe the struggle that you are living with, or your client is living with, or your family or your business is living with. So identify what that conflict is. It can be internal. It can be mental. It can be philosophical. It can be emotional. It can be physical. It really all depends upon how you frame the struggle of what you're up against. It may be, if we're talking about flood insurance, the inertia of the legislative body ignoring the need to renew and pass flood insurance. It may be something at the state legislative level. But the point is, you want to describe it in terms of a struggle. It's okay to play the underdog. You can turn weakness into strength. Politicians love being there at the finish line with David when he beats Goliath. That is what they live for. I can tell you that, having worked on Capitol Hill and worked with politicians for over three decades, that's what they want to do. They want to be at that moment when the struggle ends and you win. We're going to come to that in a second. But first, we want to introduce another element that's a little tricky and a little hard sometimes to introduce into a story. And that is element number four, the discovery. If you can slip in a surprise at some point in a story, it's going to capture their attention. And the surprise that probably was the biggest surprise almost of all movie making happened in this movie right here. And spoiler alert, folks, if you haven't seen The Empire Strikes Back, please cover your ears right now.
Obi-Wan never told you what happened to your father.
He told me enough. He told me you killed him.
No, I am your father.
Sorry if I spoil it for you all, you guys. Yeah, that is true. Darth Vader is Luke Skywalker's father, but he turns out nice in the end. The point is that it shocked us all in the movie theaters when this moment happened. So I don't think you can do it in the same way George Lucas can, but think about it, and think about it when it's going to have the most impact. I remember we were doing a training session with a group of patient advocates, and along with these patients, one of their doctors had come along, and he was going to go to one of the meetings. And he was doing his story, and he was describing in vivid detail what it's like to live with the disease. In fact, more detail than you would expect for a physician. And he got to the end of the story, and he says, the reason I know so much about this disease is I have it. And it was at the end of the story, he could have knocked us over with a feather. It was amazing. So think about when it's going to have the most impact. Sometimes it happens at the beginning of a story that shocked. I was doing another patient advocate group. This was a group of dermatologists, and they brought in some of their patients. And this woman started her story this way. I am diagnosed with basal skin cancer 300 times a year. I'm like, whoa. You know, as a skin cancer survivor, I'm like very aware of that, but since many people are. But again, thinking about when it has the most impact, try to balance it out. How does it fit into your story from the past and the present? And what did you learn? And how did that learning impact your life, others in the industry, and in the future? So that's the discovery element, element number four. Element number five, we can win. Introduce the potential of success and joy. Success is when the hero or heroine wins. Joy is when the audience participates in that experience. The phrase we use, you're going to see in the handout, is you finish this sentence. Congresswoman, we have the opportunity to. Boom. That's what they're listening for too. That's almost the ask. Like, we have the opportunity to win the battle against cancer. We have the opportunity to roll back taxes to a point where people can actually afford a home. You know, you have to fill in the blanks. But the idea here is that you want to introduce the possibility that they can win. And the movie clip I'm going to share with you is one from great literature, probably one of the greatest films ever made. And of course, that is Animal House. And it's a scene in which John Belushi gives a rallying cry to his fellow frat brothers.
What? Over? Did you say over? Nothing is over until we decide it is. Was it over when the Germans bombed Pearl Harbor? Hell no!
Germans? Forget it, he's rolling.
And it ain't over now. Because when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Who's with me? Let's go! Come on!
So hopefully your rallying speech will be a little more successful than Ludo's here. You know, by the way, I just, you know, parenthetical 2020 note, the rest of this film is about as politically incorrect as possible. I am banning it from my library from now on. I watched this show, of course, when I was 18 years old. I thought it was an instructional video on how to go to college. Big mistake there. Anyway, the point is you want to introduce the possibility of success and joy, of where the hero and the heroine wins. And when the audience participates, I remember being in settings where that happened on Capitol Hill, where the audience in this particular case was maybe a lawmaker who might have helped at the end of a long struggle. So think about that, because this is a big part of storytelling. It has to be almost in every advocacy story. You might be able to skip discovery, maybe even not paint the picture, but you have to have that point in which you give them that opportunity to live with you in the moment and experience that success. Senator, we have the opportunity to, and fill in the blank. Then finally, when we were doing this research and building this program, we learned a little bit about Hollywood screenwriting. We studied monologue writing, and we learned a phrase that is used by screenwriters I had never heard. And it's the term that is used for the last sentence in a movie. And that's called the button. So you want to finish with a hook. You want to have a really powerful ending. You want to rehearse it. You want to write it out and think about it. And of course, probably one of the most famous ending lines we can think of comes from The Wizard of Oz.
And you're all here, and I'm not going to leave here ever, ever again, because I love you all. And, oh, Annie M, there's no place like home.
I just love that. So think about how that button is going to affect your story. Have your ending memorized and know when to use it. And again, exercise restraint. As I described earlier, that last line makes a difference. Probably one of the best buttons I heard in our advocacy training happened with another patient advocacy group. And this was dealing with the National MS Society. And people had prepared their stories in advance for this training. So this gentleman was very well prepared, and he was, if he could stand, he was wheelchair bound, easily 6'4". He was a former Marine from North Carolina. And this is how he ended his story that he was practicing and he was going to deliver later that day to a member of Congress. And he said like this, "Congressman, I have a granddaughter. She's 4 years old. She calls me her Baba, and she's everything in the world to me. And before I came on this trip, my granddaughter asked me, Baba, when are your hands going to stop shaking? Congressman, what should I tell her?" And we were all like, whoa, that is some pretty tough stuff. That's what you have to do. And you don't have to be a patient advocate. I've seen people ending with great buttons on campaign finance reform, which I couldn't believe it. I've had them do small businesses, do a really good job with it. And you're all part of that world. You can think of what's going to capture their attention. Your metric, more than anything else, is it's 10 o'clock at night. And that lawmaker calls her spouse and says, how was your day? And the lawmaker says, you know, I had this meeting with this realtor from El Paso who told me I couldn't believe it. And boom, that's your metric. You want to be so memorable that when that lawmaker is talking to their spouse, they're telling them and retelling your story. Now, while not part of the elements, it's always important to remember you need to practice. Just like we did in Ferris Bueller's Day Off. Practice, practice, practice. The first time that you do a story should not be when you are in front of a United States senator or a state senator. You should practice it. Now, I've given you the six elements of storytelling, and I'm going to share with you now a story that we recorded from one of your colleagues. I think this was from Wisconsin. I'm not sure. And it's going to sound pretty familiar to you, hopefully, because it's a story that maybe you could write yourselves. Let's listen to their story. And while we're listening to it, I'm going to be showing you the elements of storytelling. It'll be on the screen because it's going to be an audio version only. And I want you to see if you can hear these elements and when they occur. Let's listen.
My older son, Max, entered the fourth grade when we moved to Cranford in 2005. On his first day of school, he met a boy named Adam Gurman, who would become and remains to this very day his best friend. Max spent a lot of time at Adam's house over the years, and since he was an only child, Adam's parents, Janet and Gary, kind of adopted Max. And Max still considers Janet his second mom. In 2011, Hurricane Irene hit, and the Gurmans' home flooded, completely filling their basement and reaching about 8 inches onto their first floor. Thankfully, they had flood insurance. And while the flood insurance did ensure that their house was not a total loss, the settlement that they received did not completely cover their expenses. In 2012, with Adam getting ready to head to college, the Gurmans decided to downsize a bit, allowing them to use some of the proceeds to pay for Adam's education. Due to the stigma that homes in the flood zone had after Hurricane Irene, their home value had depreciated significantly. However, we figured out a marketing plan, put the house up for sale, and obtained a buyer. And the Gurmans found a lovely new home to purchase, still in Cranford, the town that they love and call home. About 3 weeks before their closings, the National Flood Insurance Program expired. The buyers for the Gurmans' home could no longer get their mortgage and had to cancel their purchase. In turn, the Gurmans could not purchase the new home that they had found. By the time the NFIP was reauthorized, it was too late. The Gurmans' home value declined even further due to uncertainty, and they never did sell. Adam had to take out larger student loans since the money that his family thought they'd have was never realized. Now he will have more debt to pay back after graduating. Congress has a chance to make sure that situations like this are prevented from happening again. By reauthorizing the National Flood Insurance Program, we can ensure that tens of thousands of home sales don't stall and that homeowners nationwide are protected.
Now, I think you're probably smiling to yourself because you now have become experts at storytelling. You heard different elements of that story. Let's reverse engineer, and I'm going to show you exactly what the storyteller did, and I think you're going to remember it when I show it to you again. So how did he establish the stakes? My older son, Max, entered the fourth grade when we moved to Cranford in 2005. So we're telling a story of families. That's what's going on here. And what's at stake, of course, in this particular case, is what happens to their world. They paint the picture a little bit here when they were talking about Adam and Janet still being kind of a second mom. Painting the pictures. When Hurricane Irene hit, their home was flooded. So you're already starting to get a picture in your mind's eye of what this was like. By the way, definitely not a Wisconsin realtor. I got that state mixed up because Wisconsin doesn't get hit with floods. The water completely flooded their basement, reaching about 8 inches above their floor. Now, you see, you don't have to be more descriptive than that. You know, that still paints more of a picture than just saying they had a flood or seeing a talking point or a spreadsheet that says they had a flood. This is a little bit better, as you can tell. The struggle. Thankfully, they had insurance, but it didn't cover all their losses. So you're already getting a picture here of people that are not completely made whole, that are still having some challenges and some problems associated. That's the struggle that they're going through. That's the problem that they have to deal with, is this struggle. And so as you paint your picture and as you talk about it, it's really important that you think about that struggle. As I said, some of the elements you might be able to get away with not including, like a surprise, or for example, painting the picture. But the elements you have to have in every great advocacy story we've already discussed here, it's setting the stage, the struggle, and the opportunity to win. introducing the possibility of joint success. In this case, they went on to talk about Adam had to take out larger student loans. Now he'll have more debt to pay after graduation. So you see here, the struggle is getting more difficult. It isn't just about the home. It's now bleeding into their son, Adam, and having a negative effect on them. The ancillary impact, both negative and positive, of public policy decisions is essential for people like you to communicate to lawmakers, and it's what is least frequently done. And this is especially true, frankly, when you're talking to lawmakers that are looking for that return on investment, whether it's for a program expenditure or for not authorizing a program. And in this particular case, you can see here this struggle that the ancillary effect is affecting the kids' ability to go to college because they were gonna use some of the funds here. Another group I've seen this do very, very well are advocates for hunger and anti-hunger programs. And the ancillary effect of a school lunch program, for example, is kids don't get a lunch, they're not gonna study. If they don't study, they don't graduate high school, they don't become taxpayers. Okay, boom, you just won over all the Republicans in the room where you know, the Democrat might've just been won over, I'm feeding a hungry kid. I know I'm being stereotypical here, but I'm not that far off the stereotype, folks. I'm working with Congress a really long time and I've just seen this in action, that is what the talking points people use. But you know, sometimes other parties wanna see a farther down the road return on investment. So think about the programs you're talking about and the ancillary effects. Your industry is one of the core industries of the community. And I'm sure it has an incredible ripple effect. How many painters are hired as a result of remodeling that happens after someone buys a home? How many carpenters? You know, think about the ancillary effect. It's not just about that family and their home and your firm. It's about all the other people and citizens and constituents that state or federal lawmaker has that is affected by that particular program that is affecting your industry, which is core to our economy. So be creative as you describe the struggle. Have that discovery, if you can, in mind and bring it out at the appropriate moment. This one was a doozy. By the time the National Flood Insurance Program had been reauthorized, it was too late. The home declined further and they never did sell. Wow, that's terrible. That obviously is an incredibly practical impact of, frankly, in this particular case, Congress not doing its job. You can find other examples, probably at the state legislative level. But the point is that you want to think about when you're going to introduce that element. It might tell itself naturally. In this case, the storyteller was going in generally chronological order as the Gelmans were trying to sell their home and move into a new house and use some of the proceeds for Adam's education. And sometimes it plays out chronologically. Sometimes it doesn't. Sometimes reverse chronological order is a great way to tell a story. I was walking down Main Street after the flood from the hurricane and there was debris everywhere. But let me tell you what it looked like a week ago. You know, so you have to think it through. And I hope you're realizing that regular storytelling and advocacy storytelling is not that much different. I've done training with realtors now going on 10 years. And frankly, you guys are the best at this. And when I talk to Congress, they tell me, I'm not just saying this, they tell that your industry, and it's natural, right? Because this is what you do. You build relationships and you're trying to paint a picture for people of what their world might look like. In your case, with a home or with a community. And I think that's something that comes natural to you. So think about how you're going to craft your story. Element number 5, what's the introduction of success and joy? Did you hear the storyteller say, we have a chance to prevent situations like this from happening? He literally filled in the blank and put that element into its proper place. So keep that in mind as you are building your story that usually does come to at the end. So some of these elements can be interchanged and come at different times. Remember, we talked about the discovery can come at the beginning, the middle, the end. It really is the storyteller's choice on when it's going to have the greatest impact. But we can win usually comes at the end. And it's usually what we call in, as you know, the ask. It's getting close to the ask. It's introducing what that element is. And then finally, the last one, the button, the last line, this storyteller, and ensure that tens of thousands of homes don't stall and that homeowners nationwide are protected. Okay, not exactly Alfred Hitchcock lines, but still it gets the point across. And it's going to be something they're going to be thinking about because they recognize that this is a problem that they're going to have to deal with. So keep that in mind as you are building out your stories. So before we go, we're going to go to Q&A a little early here, but before we go to Q&A, I do want to walk you through the resource we're going to be providing to you, and you're going to be emailed later on. And it's this workout, this handout right here. Now, let me just walk you really quickly through it. After you get through, begin with the end in mind. You then go on to the opening, set the stage. The possible sentence could be the best or worst thing that could happen. Or if we don't do X, Y will happen. Now, as you build your story and fill us in these blanks, I don't want you going 1 through 6. You know, you should, the opening of course comes at the beginning and the button comes at the end. But the struggle, painting the picture, the discovery, that you have some flexibility with. But what you'll find, if you do this with a friend and a colleague, and you can do it in a virtual environment, you're gonna find your story coming together. Second, painting the picture. We said, what did you see, feel, hear, sense, taste, or smell? And don't hold anything back. I could hear the wind rippling through the windows as the glass was cracked. Something, you know, I'm not that dramatic, but you get the idea. We've talked about playing the underdog in number 3 and the struggle. We've talked about the discovery and trying to put it in context, you know, and we learned that, you know, Adam couldn't go to college, or Adam had to get extra loans out in order to go to college. We heard the we can win, we have the opportunity to moment, right? And then of course, you have to finish your L. So this is how you do the exercise with a friend. Let me walk you through this. So go on these steps. First, the first thing to do is to take a piece of paper and a pen and just kind of write out, don't use this handout at first, and write out the elements, the bullet points on what your story is. And use names. Remember how we heard Adam, Janet? You know, you can make up the names if you're worried about, you know, giving out information that's not able to get out. But the point is that you want to, in a bullet point format, write out your story, okay? Then, if you can, record your story on your phone. Just go ahead and turn it on and sit there, go to the recording function and record it yourself. And just sort of do it. It's going to make you feel a little self-conscious, but if you're alone in your office or something like that, it'll still feel good. As I said earlier, the first time that you do this should not be in front of a lawmaker whose decision you are dependent upon. So practice it out. After you've recorded it to yourself, when you play it back, try to capture in the form different elements. You're going to see to yourself where something might be missing. Ideally, you could do this with another colleague, where you pass out the form. If you can do it like this, talking this way or talking to the screen or talking as if it's third party, that's okay. And of course, most people have the capability of recording these things when you're in a Zoom call or a GoToMeeting call or something like that. But as you hear me talk about this, I know this is gonna at first feel a little weird and strange that you're crafting this, but as you saw from the research, most people don't do this when they interact with a lawmaker. Only 18% on our survey, so 1 out of 5. You want to differentiate yourself from 4 out of 5 people, then begin to tell a story and craft it out. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and turn it back to Tom and the others. I'm getting a little ahead of myself. I talked a little too fast today, but I'd be happy to answer any questions that are coming up along the way.
Well, thank you, Brad, for this insightful presentation and teaching us how we can best make an impact through our stories. I particularly love The Wizard of Oz, so thanks. It's a great, great movie. So let's see if we have any questions. Do you think there's a difference between virtual storytelling and one in person? And which one would you think is more or less effective?
I don't think... frankly, I think the most effective storytelling happens on the radio. I think radio and verbal is the most visual medium because you have to embed it in your mind's eye. But that's, again, as you heard, I started in radio. You do lose something when you are not in person. But one of the things I would encourage you to do that people are starting to do is using technology to their advantage. You know, so let's say you recorded somebody's story and you interview somebody. Well, you can just take your little iPhone here and stick it up to the microphone and play that story. You can use other visuals. One of the visuals I like to use, since we started going in a Zoom world, I'm not encouraging you to do it, but it always brings a laugh, is having a avatar. Who's my avatar? I have my Mr. Spock finger puppet. He's never far from my hands. So I bring him in. So that's one thing you can do. The other thing you can do that you can't do as well in person, or that you could, but it seemed awkward, is showing photographs, is sharing the screen. Let me show you some of the damage that happened as a result of this. That, again, you just differentiated yourself from dozens of other people. If you are ready to share a screen, to share a photograph, make sure you can follow up by email electronically. Of course, in person is always going to be more powerful, but because we're getting better at this, I think there are really robust, rich opportunities to use technology to an advantage when it comes to storytelling. And the other thing about storytelling and virtual, when we talk to people about doing a virtual site visit with a lawmaker, you really are the director of a play. You really are thinking through, okay, who's going to talk first? What are we going to show? What do we want the lawmaker to do at the end? You're really thinking it through. So in fact, more in a virtual environment, you do become the Steven Spielberg of the whole movie making experience, except it's an advocacy experience. So I think you do have the potential of thinking things through. And then of course, the great part about technology is you can bring in actors from all over the state. You know, you've got someone in El Paso and Austin and in Galveston, they can come in where that might frankly be cost prohibitive in another environment. So I do think there's ways that can that make it happen. Thank you for that question.
Well, thanks. How about in the past, some of our legislative visits are on a pretty strict time crunch. Do you have any tips for us on reducing or expanding our stories in a way that's still effective, but mindful of a lawmaker's time?
Thank you. Well, the story you heard was 2 minutes and 38 seconds. So I think if you're well-disciplined and prepared, you can tell a great story in a very brief period of time. So I'm mindful of that. What I do see happening sometimes in in-person meetings is we have a joke in Washington. Not everything has been said. It just hasn't been said by everybody, which I could be describing in the United States Senate on any given day, having worked as a Senate for 5 years. So I think be mindful. We don't want to have multiple people take up lawmakers' time to be repetitive. So again, that's why I think preparation is the key. Somebody was going into a group and they were meeting with a Pennsylvania senator, and they said, which one of us should talk first? And I said, easy, who's got the best story? And so they literally then confabbed for 15 minutes and they said, oh, Irene over here, she's got the best story, she should tell it. She's got a great story. You'll find who has the best story to tell it quickly. Another way to do it and to keep in mind is knowing how long you have. If you've only got 7 minutes, and sometimes that's the case in Washington meetings, you know, in the district, in Congress, you're going to have more time. And certainly with state legislators that are not in session, if they're in that window when the Texas legislature is in session, I know that's a very small window, that is a little bit more tight. But again, preparation and rehearsing are your friends. That's going to get you out of that situation.
Okay, I think we got time for one more here. What do you think about sharing someone else's story? Or is it much more effective to just use your own?
Well, here's two schools of thought. I'm going to sound strange. The first training course I got in sales was when I was selling radio, and I took the course, Human Relations and Effective Speaking, which was designed by Dale Carnegie. And the first rule of telling stories that Carnegie teaches us is, have you earned the right to tell the story? So that would be the way I would frame it. It's not, is it your story or is it someone else's story, but have you earned the right to tell the story? Now, in this particular case, the real estate agent knew the Gelmans and tried to make a deal for them. He'd earned the right. He was part of the story. You don't have to be part of the story if you've got a great story. In fact, if you are advocating on behalf of others, that actually is an advantage in an advocacy setting, because many people are going in and they're advocating for themselves, right? You know, doctor comes in and says they want to increase Medicaid reimbursement rates to practices because they say, if we don't do this, more doctors are going to drop Medicaid and that'll make it more difficult for people to go to the hospital. Okay, that's true. But if we increase rates, it's more money for you. So it's not quite the same thing. Now, in your case, there are going to be times where you are going to advocate for yourself. You know, you're going to be, but most of the time, you're going to be advocating for your clients because what's good for them is good for you. What's good for the home builders or someone else in your field is good for you. So I think the more you can frame it as you being an advocate for a cause, as opposed to your own self-interest, it's always going to be viewed a little differently by the lawmaker and their staff.
Okay. Well, thank you. All right. There's no further questions at this time. Brad, do you have any closing thoughts before I wrap this up, my friend?
Yeah, I do. I realize that when you start this exercise and you start this experience, it's going to be awkward to go all the way through it. But I strongly urge you to think it through. Just like if you're staging a home, you're going to have to think about the different elements that have to be changed in order to tell the story of that beautiful home. Think of it the same way. It's going to be a little awkward at first. It's going to be a little messy. Yeah, you got to get the mantle redone. Oh my gosh, that vanity's got to go. But think of it that way as constructing the whole thing. And remember what Thomas Jefferson taught us, and that is that we in America do not have a government by the majority. We have a government by the majority who participate. I strongly urge you to have your voice heard in Washington and on Capitol Hill, because your voice does make a difference. And again, thank you very much for this opportunity to speak to you, and I look forward to our next training session together.
Wow. Hey, Brad, thanks so much. This is all the time we have today. And I want to thank you again, and also your firm, the Congressional Management Foundation, for kicking off our advocacy training series and our legislative contact team members. As a reminder, if you are interested in joining a contact team for your legislature, or if you're interested in joining us in our next training sessions, please contact your Texas Realtor field rep or Texas Realtors political affairs specialist, Joanna Ramirez, at jramirez@texasrealtors.com. This wraps up the broadcast of orientation for today, but please join us again tomorrow at 11 a.m. for a preview of the 87th Texas Legislature with Joe Strauss, former Speaker of the Texas House of Representatives. Then at 1 p.m., tune in for the TREPAC special programming that will have a special message from State Representative James Tallarico. And that'll be followed by our orientation closing session tomorrow at 2. You really don't want to miss it. Thanks again for joining us today. And Brad, again, a special thank you. And we'll see you all here tomorrow. Goodbye.
Then you did something wrong. You said it was great, and now you don't know how you could. To know you. To love. smashing mics in karaoke bars. You're running late with half your makeup on. This method acting might pay our bills, but soon enough there'll be a different role to fill. I love this feeling, but I hate this part. I wanted this to work so much, I drew up our plans on a chart. Cars are flipping, I'm in hot pursuit. My character's strong, but my head is loose. She hits like ecstasy. Comes over, bangs the sense out of me. The tarot cards say it's not so bad, and the blades rotate, there's just no landing pad. And better have said it, but darling, you're the best. I'm just tired of falling up the Penrose steps. I hate this feeling, but I love this part. She really wants to make it work, and I clearly wanna let it start. We'll build a water slide as soon as I get home. Oh, and she hits like ecstasy. Comes up and bangs the sense out of me. It's wrong, but sure.
She's a woman that's on your mind. She's a woman who takes her time. She's a woman that's on your mind. She's a woman who takes her time. Yes, I feel a sweet emotion every time you're near me. Every time you are near. don't have no fear. Sweet emotions, cause she's the one that's on my mind. Emotions, I feel sweet emotions. She's the one that takes my time. She's the one that's on my mind. She's the one that's on my mind. She's the one that's on my mind.